the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, we are in the middle of this Congress, and we are much privileged and gifted today, after being exposed to the many gifted and graceful reflections on the mercy of God. Now we crown it with the Eucharist. Let us remember, every time we partake in the Eucharist, the Mass is an act of compassion for all of us. For indeed, the Mass is not our prayer. The Eucharist is Christ's unique, inimitable prayer to the Father, an offering of himself to the Father. For whom? For you, you, me, all of us. It's an act of mercy of God. It's God taking, giving us that true living image of what love and compassion is. We have always said, mercy is the face of God. Jesus is the mercy of God. God made love. He is love. God is love. In Jesus, God made love, understanding, forgiveness, and he made all that visible, audible, embraceable, approachable in Jesus. Jesus is now again in memory, renewing all that for us. Whisper to Jesus what you want God to hear. Eucharist, thanking the Father for you and me. Eucharist, receiving from you even just intention to tell this to the Father. We, you, all of us are thanking God for the giftedness of life, the Eucharist. You and I, all of us, telling God we appreciate what family is, what good work is, what livelihood is, what community is. At the same time, and here is the most touching icon of mercy. He listens to us as we tell him the fragility, the selfishness of our past decisions. And so, to crown all of that today, we prepare ourselves to join Jesus, to ask Jesus to make us part of the mysteries, offering God what good we had, and asking God compassion for the mistakes we have made. Together, I confess to
Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God, the merciless, may forgive us our sins, bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, who by a singular grace gave the priest Saint Pius a share in the cross of your Son, and by means of his ministry renewed the wonders of your mercy, grant that through his intercession we may be united constantly to the sufferings of Jesus Christ, and so brought happily to the glory of the resurrection, through our Lord Jesus Christ, our Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses summoned all of Israel and said to them, "At the time the Lord set apart tribe of Levi to carry the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, to be in attendance before the Lord and minister to Him, and to give blessings in His name, as they have done to this day. For this reason, Levi has no share in the heritage with your brothers. The Lord Himself is his heritage, as the Lord your God has told him." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us join the choir in the singing of the response, "My happiness lies in you alone, O God."
Preserve me, God, I take refuge in you. I say to the Lord, you are my God. O Lord, it is you who are my portion and cup. It is you yourself who are my prize.
Let us all stand to honor the Holy Gospel.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Lord of heaven and earth, for revealing to little ones the mysteries of your kingdom. To do. Everything has been entrusted to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal Him. Come to me, all you who labor and are overburdened, and I will give you rest. Shoulder my yoke and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. And you will find rest for your souls. Yes, my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. The Gospel of the Lord.
Please remain standing.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Please be seated.
Your Eminence, Gaudencio Cardinal Rosales, Archbishop Emeritus of Manila and former Archbishop of the Archdiocese of Lipa. He was the one who erected the parish of San Padre Pio here in Barangay San Pedro, Santo Tomas, Batangas. My brother archbishops and bishops, Father Patrice Chobolsky, who is the international organizer of the Divine Mercy Apostolate, my brother priests, dear religious men and women, consecrated persons, dear delegates from overseas and delegates from other dioceses, my dear faithful of the Archdiocese of Lipa, dear people of God, my sincere and profound thanks to God and to the Fourth World Apostolic Congress on Mercy, international and national coordinators, for selecting the Lipa Archdiocese as one of the five venues for this unique gathering of Divine Mercy Pilgrims. I thank God and all of you in the name of the whole Archdiocese, priests and lay leaders and lay faithful. The distinct honor given this local church is no doubt due to being the providential site of the National Shrine of the renowned Priest of Mercy. More than 50 years ago, he already clearly demonstrated in his life that, quote, the ministry of confession is a true priestly mission. Words of Pope Francis. Saint Padre Pio makes his saintly presence plain this very day, most particularly among the hundreds of confessors who follow strictly Pope Francis' directive. Quote, to be welcoming to all, to be witnesses of fatherly love, whatever the gravity of sin involved, attentive in helping penitents to reflect on the evil they have done, clear in presenting moral principles, willing to walk patiently beside the faithful on their penitential journey, far-sighted in discerning individual cases, and generous in dispensing God's forgiveness, unquote. As you come to this sacred place, you did not fail to read the statement of San Padre Pio, purposely made visible everywhere. Pray, hope, and don't worry. This advice concurs with the observation of Pope Francis that, quote, in a culture often dominated by technology, sadness and loneliness appear to be on the rise, not least among young people. The future seems prey to an uncertainty that does not make for stability, often giving rise to depression, sadness, and boredom, which can easily lead to despair. We need witnesses to hope and true joy. The profound sense of emptiness felt by so many people can be overcome by the hope we bear in our hearts and by the joy that it gives. We need to acknowledge the joy that rises up in a heart touched by mercy, unquote. Wacom, from Rome to Krakow, from Bogota to Manila, have this as backdrop for the timely upsurge of the apostolate on divine mercy. The same Spirit spurs the divine mercy apostles from the three popes of our times to the most simple and hidden divine mercy advocate to proclaim God's mercy throughout the entire planet. The saintly Capuchin, sought daily by thousands in this place, is known as being an eminent channel of divine mercy, even long before the idea was officially accepted. So early did he endorse the cure to the present and prevalent depressive trend. Pray, hope, and don't worry. The Holy Father underscores the need to have, quote, witnesses to hope and true joy, to dispel the illusions that promise quick and easy happiness through artificial paradises, unquote. The 9-year preparation for the fifth centenary of the first baptism administered and first Eucharist celebrated in Philippine soil dedicates this year, 2017, as the year of communion of communities. The extraordinary Jubilee of Mercy celebrated by the Universal Church the entire year 2016 was inspired by Pope Francis' apostolic letter declaring Jesus Christ as the face of mercy, Misericordiae Vultus. In closing the extraordinary year, Pope Francis passionately stated that mercy be recognized as an essential feature of church life. Through the apostolic letter, Misericordia et Misera, he calls for a time of mercy. Vacuum 4 was planned years before both Misericordiae Vultus and Misericordia et Misera, but its theme, communion in mercy, mission for mercy, is an early and animated response to the Pope's challenge. The Church is truly a communion in mercy with a mission for mercy. The Church in Vacuum IV's host country reflects this entire year how to become a communion of communities. With sister churches the world over, the Church in the Philippines can draw abundant reflection points from Misericordia et Misera and from the challenge of Vacuum IV. Indeed, persons and communities must experience mercy to become authentic witnesses of mercy. As Pope Francis puts it, quote, communities alive and active in the work of evangelization, equipped with pastoral conversion, shaped daily by the renewing force of mercy, unquote. Every community and every individual therein, ordained or lay, can and must be witnesses and bearers of mercy after being and while remaining incessantly recipients of mercy. Pope Francis says, quote, the celebration of mercy takes place in a very particular way in the sacrament of penance and reconciliation. Here we feel the embrace of the Father, unquote. The priests accompanying us today spend hours assisting penitents to share the mercy of the Father. They themselves habitually experience the Father's mercy. In my 23 years of Episcopal ministry, I often remark that priests rarely available to people for the sacrament of reconciliation are those with weak faith in and scant experience of mercy. Neither can this be relied on to assist the sick and the dying. Excellent confessors, contrariwise, are cheerful penitents. Priests who regularly confess are willing, eager, and ever accessible confessors. How true is the saying, the forgiving community is a forgiving community. A forgiven church is a forgiving church. A person forgiven is likewise easily forgiving. In this year's Communion of Communities for the Church in this nation, it is crucial to recognize an important source of communion, the experience of mercy. Pope Francis puts it in even nicer terms. It is the embrace of the Father. The sacrament of reconciliation, this particular way of celebrating mercy, is the experience of being embraced by the Father. The priest, who is first of all a penitent and who consistently experiences the embrace of the Father, becomes a wonderful confessor, sharing the joy of the Father's embrace with the faithful. And the faithful, in turn, experiencing the Father's embrace, spread the beatific experience with those afflicted with resentment, anger, vengeful mood, those enduring pain, suffering, misunderstanding, persecution, those stricken with envy, jealousy, and all kinds of negativities, or wounded by betrayal, violence, rejection, and grieved by death of someone dear. This embrace of the Father brings so much happiness because it is love. Quote from Pope, we must never lose our certainty of the Lord's love for us. Unquote again from the assuring words of the Pope. The experience mercy enables us to regard all human problems from the standpoint of God's love, which never tires of welcoming and accompanying. Most of all, the embrace of the Father is really Christ, the divine mercy. Christ is God's eternal love for us. Misericordiae Vultus reminded us of the spiritual and corporal works of mercy. During the entire extraordinary Jubilee, many enthusiastically fed the hungry, gave water to the thirsty, clothed the naked, sheltered the homeless, consoled the sick, visited the prisoners, and buried the dead. Misericordia et misera encourages us to continue doing these works of mercy. And so, we instruct the ignorant, counsel the doubtful, admonish the sinner, bear patiently with those who wrong us, forgive offenses, console the afflicted, pray for the living and dead. In addition, Pope Francis urges us, and we heed his directive, to care for our common home. Some, however, feel that doing good things to others does not yet guarantee experience of mercy. The loving embrace of the Father makes us one with divine mercy himself, Jesus Christ. Thereby, we become full-time witnesses and purveyors of mercy. We become, through Christ, the divine mercy, more fully vehicle of mercy, individuals, or a communion in mercy with a mission for mercy. Christ is alive among us. This should become more visible to all. Mercy is not merely a fleeting act, a momentary gesture of goodness, similar to flickering lights. It is rather a personal encounter, a life fusion, an ongoing and lasting union with divine mercy himself. Imagine Christ, who embraces with the Father's merciful love the addict, fearful for his life, in danger of being snuffed out by a gun held by a former colleague in crime. Christ embraces too the wayward girl, deprived of caring presence of loving parents. They were forced to seek livelihood far away, dreaming for her a bright future, slowly turning, however, into a nightmare due to misguided search for affection. Think of Christ embracing the farmer and the fisher folk, reduced to extreme misery because of a promised progress that excludes poor people like them. He embraces too an antisocial person feeling never-ending rejection by others. He speaks even on mercy himself because of utter desperation. Christ embraces the miserable, the unwanted, the neglected, the forgotten. Christ, the face of mercy, misericordiae vultus, is more real if he is seen as one who, while remaining sinless, became sin. He does not shrink to be the life-threatened addict, or the abused youth, or the impoverished farmer fisher folk, or the very sick and abandoned, the imprisoned threatened with capital punishment, the exploited, the orphan, the unborn unwanted by self-centered parents, the children of delinquent and vicious elders, the refugee escaping from the destructive war games, the senseless, powerful, and mighty play seated in their comfortable thrones. Divine mercy himself pleads for mercy by being miserable, being the miserable, misericordia et misera. The extraordinary Jubilee Mercy 2016 faded into yesterday, but 2017 brightens with Vacuum Force challenge to be a communion of mercy and to be a community with a mission for mercy. To become the church in mercy, sent on a mission of mercy, the church has to live being the body of Christ, the body of divine mercy. Mercy is no mere attribute of the church. Due to her incorporation to Christ, the divine mercy, the church must herself be mercy. Finally, how can we fail to recognize the strong presence of an important role of Mary, the Mother of Mercy? She personifies the church so intimately and inseparably united to divine mercy, her son. The host archdiocese gladly dedicates the whole year 2017 a reflection on her, who 100 years ago in Fatima and various times and in many other places has always shown herself the mother of divine mercy. She is the perfect model of all of us who, embraced by the Father, are called to extend that embrace to the whole of humanity and the entire creation. Mother of Mercy, help us to live as a community of mercy, called to spread mercy everywhere. For with your Son and you, drawing us to yourselves, the time of mercy has come and is here to stay. Amen.
Please remain seated for some moments of reflection. Please stand.
Thank you.
Dear brothers and sisters, gathered as one to celebrate the good things we have received from our God, let us ask Him now to prompt in us prayers that are worthy of His hearing. Our response will be,
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Francis, our Pope, and all the bishops and all the clergy, with the people entrusted to their charge, may they always be animated by love and mercy in forming the one body of Christ.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who hold public office and those who assist them in promoting the common good, may they be faithful in serving the people of God.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who travel by sea, land, or air, for captives and all held in prison, may they always feel the presence of God in their lives and in the lives of their families.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered in this sacred place, by faith and devotion, and by love and reverence for God.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. May the petitions of your church be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, so that we may receive from your mercy what we cannot ask out of confidence in our own merits. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please be seated.
Save the Lord. pray, brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His holy church.
Receive, O Lord, we now pray, the offerings placed on your altar in commemoration of Saint Father Pio, that as you brought him glory, you may, through these sacred mysteries, grant to us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. It is our duty in salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For on the festival and in the of the devotion to Saint Padre Pio, you bid your church to rejoice, so also you strengthen her by the example of his holy life, teach her by his words of preaching, and keep her safe in answer to his prayers. And so now, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we now acclaim.
For those who cannot kneel, please remain standing, but with reverence.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things, and you make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought you for consecration, that they may become the body and the blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we now celebrate these mysteries. For on the night that he was betrayed, he himself took bread. And give you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Father and Son, and Spirit, in a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and gave you with thanks. He said the blessing, gave the chalice to the disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Father, said by all. The mystery of faith.
We must hear of the word.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you now in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with the Holy Spirit, may become one body and one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Padre Pio, and with all the saints on his constant intercession in your presence, we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, with Ramon, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops and all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you
the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we now dare to say.
Oh,
deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may always be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accord with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.